and closing words this morning will be from Walt Whitman, who was to have said that, with the exception of his mother, he felt closer to Lincoln than anyone in his life, even though he had never met Lincoln. The following words were written by Whitman on April 19th, just a few days following Lincoln's death. Hushed be the camps today, and soldiers, let us drape our war-worn weapons, and each with musing soul retire to celebrate our dear commander's death. No more for him life's stormy conflicts, nor victory, nor defeat. No more time's dark events, charging like ceaseless clouds across the sky. But sing poet in our name, sing of the love we bore him, because you, dweller in camps, know it truly. As they invault the coffin there, sing, as they close the doors of the earth upon him, one verse for the heavy hearts of soldiers. We're most fortunate this morning to have Michael Burlingame with us to speak on Mourning Lincoln in this, the 150th year since President Lincoln's death, and with the Funeral Coalition activities which Springfield will be hosting in early May. Michael is an internationally known Lincoln scholar who has 12 published books about Lincoln. His two-volume set, Abraham Lincoln, A Life, was said to be the essential title for the bicentennial. Doris Kearns Goodwin said of that set, Lincoln scholars waited for this book for decades. No one in recent history has uncovered more fresh resources than Michael Burlingame. This profound and masterful portrait will be read and studied for years to come. Michael Burlingame is the holder of the Chancellor Naomi B. Lynn Distinguished Chair in Lincoln Studies at the University of Illinois in Springfield. He was inducted into the Lincoln Academy in 2009. Without further ado, I'd like to welcome Michael Burlingame.
Well, thank you very much, Penny, and thank you for inviting me to speak. I had the pleasure of speaking here a while back in 2009. And it's always an honor to be invited to speak at a venue like this, but it's a special honor to be invited back to a venue like this. Happy Washington's birthday, by the way. Now, when I was a kid growing up, there was a big distinction between February 12th, Lincoln's birthday, and February 22nd, Washington's birthday, and now we have this rather anodyne President's Day, which I think is an unfortunate development. Partly because it ruins the effect of one of my favorite cartoons, something that appeared in the New Yorker about 30 years ago. It shows Lincoln at the foot of the steps in the White House, calling up and saying, Mary, he says, it's February 12th. I can never remember. Is this my birthday or George Washington's? Well, Penny very kindly offered me a cough drop. Before I came up here, and I've got it here in my pocket, ready for the, in the case of emergency. And I told her it reminded me of an event that occurred back in 2009. I was invited by the Attorney General to come to Washington and speak to him and some of his staff about Lincoln and civil liberties. So I went down. It was a noontime talk, and I had a cold, and I was being shown the ropes by the Attorney General's assistant. And I told him, I said, I have this cold, and every now and then I have a coughing spasm, and what I'd like to do, if it's okay with you, is unwrap some cough drops and put them on the podium so that in case while I was talking I did develop a coughing spasm, I could, instead of unwrapping a cough drop and going through all that motion, I could just reach down and grab one. He said, that's fine, so I did so. Then the Attorney General was about to introduce me, and I told him before he went out, I said, no, when you get out there, you're going to see some cough drops unwrapped on that podium. Now, those are mine, not yours, okay? And so afterwards, I was speaking with him, and he said, well, thank goodness you didn't have a coughing spasm during your talk. And I said, that's thanks to good old codeine. And he said, don't mention that word in this building. There are DEA agents all over the place. People keep asking me, what am I going to do as part of the funeral commemoration later this spring? And I assure them that I'm going to be the corpse. Oh, and I heard that interns are now serving as pinch hitters for Minister Wolf when he's on sabbatical. And I keep telling my students, Abraham Lincoln freed the interns. So apparently that hasn't gotten out to your friend. Right? Okay. Well, okay. Enough hilarity. What I'd like to do today is focus on a couple of themes about mourning Lincoln, particularly the way in which large numbers of people regarded Lincoln's death as though they had lost their father. This was a remarkable image that was used in sermons and newspaper editorials and letters and diary entries about how the death of Lincoln reminded people of the death of their father, or it felt as though they had lost their father. And it was particularly striking that this image was used not just among the general population, but also particularly among the black population. And then I would like to reflect a little upon how that imagery helped Lincoln during his presidency become such a successful national leader. So by your leave, I'm going to read some statements that were made, many of them on what was known as Black Easter, which was April 16th, 1865, the day after Lincoln died. Lincoln was shot on Good Friday, died the following day, and then of course, the following Sunday was Easter. Oh, and I'm reminded of a woman who read a little book to her four-year-old son about Lincoln's life and death. And so when she was finished, her son said, "Now, Mommy, do I have this story straight? The president went to the theater, and he was watching a play, and he got shot while watching the play. But he didn't die till the next morning." And his mother said, "That's right, son." And the little boy thought about that and thought about it and thought about it and said finally, "Well, Mommy, at least he got to see the end of the play." Okay, that's, all right, enough hilarity, second time. Okay, April 16th, 1865, the Unitarian minister James Freeman Clark in Boston told his congregation that John Wilkes Booth's act, quote, was not only assassination, it was parricide, for Abraham Lincoln was as a father to the whole nation. The nation felt orphaned yesterday morning. Another Massachusetts minister, the Congregationalist Elias Nason, likened the pain caused by Lincoln's death to the, quote, profound personal grief we feel as when a dear old father, a beloved mother, or a brother is torn relentlessly from our breast. To Nason, the widespread grieving, quote, is not mourning for some great national loss only. It was instead lamentation for one who has been very near and very dear to us, for one who seemed to be of the immediate circle of our own familiar friends and acquaintances, for one who had so identified himself with our own views that he seemed to be an elementary part of our own being, bone of our bone, blood of our blood, for one so entirely with us in sympathy, in genius, in love, in action, in aspiration, that he must ever bear the august title, the people's own beloved president. Even the little children looked upon him as their own kind-hearted father." Other Boston preachers joined in this mourner's chorus. "We have slept securely. We have dismissed anxiety and fear because our father was at the helm," observed Edward Norris Kirk, pastor of the Congregationalist Old South Church. "But he is gone, dead, murdered." In Shawmut Church, another Congregationalist minister, Edwin Webb, exclaimed that the nation has lost a father, the human race a sincere, devoted, and able leader. The Swedenborgian minister, James Reed, told his flock on April 19th, "We all feel today as if a father had been taken away from us." And the Unitarian divine, Henry C. Badger, referred to Lincoln as the father of his people. Andrew Leach Stone, pastor of the Congregational Park Street Church in Boston, predicted that generations to come shall speak his name as our father spoke of the name of Washington, and shall grow up revering and guarding the hallowed memory of his second father of his country, whom history will write also the father of our race. Many other clergy echoed this paternal theme. A Baptist preacher in Philadelphia lamented that the nation's father has been struck down in all his gentle kingliness. A pastor in Maine told his parishioners, "Our father has fallen and we feel ourselves orphans." 3 days later, he remarked that it would seem strange to one who did not know the circumstances of the case to hear how often the word father has fallen from the trembling lips these last few days. "I feel," says one and another, "as if I had lost my father, or as I did when my father died." Such is the common feeling and the common word. Here in Illinois, a Presbyterian minister in Freeport noted that the country loved Lincoln as it never loved another. He was the best and greatest. The greatest because the best, the most loving, the most lovable, the most brotherly, the most fatherly man of all our rulers. How remarkable the affection of the people for this man. Theodore Cuyler, the pastor of the largest Presbyterian congregation in the entire country, was so distraught by the assassination of the man he called a dear departed father, and Cuyler had been a member of something called the Christian Commission, which had a lot of dealings with the president, so he got to know the president personally as well as through the newspapers, that he could not write out a sermon that day. He therefore spoke extemporaneously to his Brooklyn congregation, saying that, quote, "The plain, homespun, kind-voiced president was so near to every one of us, so like our own relative, that we were wont to call him Uncle Abe and Father Abraham. There was no disrespect in this, but rather a respect so deep and honest that it could afford to be familiar." Cuyler concluded that our father died at the right time, for his mighty work was done. Another New York preacher noted that the father of the country is slain and a whole nation are mourners. A Methodist minister in Buffalo said somehow we all felt that he was a brother and a friend to us all. Unconsciously to ourselves, we felt a deep personal interest in him and affection for him. His great soul had drawn us to him, and now we mourn for him as though a father or a brother had been taken away from us. This theme was also echoed among black clergymen. In Troy, New York, an African-American preacher mourned Lincoln as, quote, the father of our nation. Another African-American minister there in Troy, New York, elaborated, saying, we, as a people, feel more than all others that we are bereaved. We had learned to love Mr. Lincoln as we have never loved man before. We idolized his very name. We looked up to him as our savior, our deliverer. His name was familiar to our children, and our prayers ascended to God in his behalf. He had taught us to love him. The interest he manifested in behalf of the oppressed, the weak, and those who had none to help them had won for him a large place in our heart. It was something so new to us to see such sentiments manifested by the chief magistrate of the United States that we could not help but love him. The congregation of the African American Zion Baptist Church in Cincinnati heard its ministers proclaim that if Lincoln's assassinated had, quote, given us blacks the choice to deliver him or ourselves to death, we would have said, take me, take father, take mother, take sister, take brother, but do not take the life of the father of this people. He noted that every freedman wept at the death of our father, Abraham Lincoln. Now, the most eloquent eulogy delivered by a black in the immediate aftermath of Lincoln's death was not a preacher, but Frederick Douglass. Did any of you get to hear the Frederick Douglass presenter who was here last week speaking at the University of Illinois and then at the Lincoln banquet on the High Holy Day? Okay, well, okay, so I'm sorry more of you didn't get to hear him. This is a wonderful presenter who gave the eulogy that Frederick Douglass delivered in New York City at Cooper Union on June 1st, 1865, which was the last official day of mourning for Lincoln. And this is a remarkable tribute to Lincoln that Frederick Douglass delivered on June 1st, 1865. And you'll see that it has some pretty remarkable language. And I think when I spoke here 5 years ago, I may have mentioned this, that almost everybody who writes about Frederick Douglass and Abraham Lincoln and race talks about a speech that Frederick Douglass gave in 1876, in which Frederick Douglass said that Abraham Lincoln was preeminently the white man's president, and we black people were only his stepchildren. Preeminently the white man's president. And this speech is very well known. It's cited by everybody who talks about Lincoln and race, who writes about that subject. And so you might imagine my surprise when I'm going through the Frederick Douglass papers at the Library of Congress and discover in his handwriting a speech that he had delivered on June 1st, 1865, in which he said, as you'll see, that Lincoln was emphatically the black man's president. Emphatically the black man's president. The first to rise above the prejudice of his time and his country by inviting me, Frederick Douglass, to come to the White House to consult with him on matters of state, he was saying through that gesture, I am the president of the black people as well as the white people, and I mean to honor their rights as men and citizens. And when I read that speech, I was astounded seeing it in Frederick Douglass's handwriting in the Frederick Douglass papers at the Library of Congress, because I had read through the five-volume edition of Frederick Douglass's speeches that had been published by the Yale University Press a generation or 10, 20 years earlier. And I thought, well, how could I have missed this speech? So I went to the shelf in the library and picked out volume 3, which contains the Civil War speeches of Douglass. And I flipped, got to June 1st, 1865, and there was nothing. I couldn't believe it. The speech had been omitted. Five fat volumes. And this remarkable speech was not among them. So I wrote to the people at Yale and said, what's up? Why did you omit this speech? No response. I wrote to the, I gave a call. I left a voicemail message. No response. Well, those of us who went to Princeton aren't surprised Yale would behave this way, but what can I tell you, right? So let me share with you some of the passages from that remarkable eulogy that Frederick Douglass gave on June 1st, 1865. Douglass said, no people or class of people in the country have a better reason for lamenting the death of Abraham Lincoln and for desiring to honor and perpetuate his memory than have the colored people. He said that the record of the martyred president, when compared with, quote, the long line of his predecessors, many of whom were merely the facile and servile instruments of the slave power, was impressive. Douglass acknowledged that Lincoln was unsurpassed in his devotion to the welfare of the white race, and that sometimes he smote blacks and wounded them severely. Nevertheless, he was also, and here's the key quote, in a sense, hitherto without example, emphatically the black man's president, the first to show any respect for their rights as men. He was the first American president who rose above the prejudice of his times and country. He went on to say that if during the early stages of the Civil War the president had favored colonizing the freedmen abroad, Douglass asserted, Lincoln soon outgrew his colonization ideas and schemes and came to look upon the black man as an American citizen. To illustrate this point, Douglass cited his own personal experience. It was my privilege to know Abraham Lincoln and to know him well. I saw and conversed with him at different times during his administration. Douglass found Lincoln's willingness to receive him remarkable in and of itself. Douglass said he knew that he could do nothing which would call down upon him more fiercely the ribaldry of the vulgar than by showing any respect to a colored man. In a draft of this speech, Douglass said, some men there are who can face death and dangers but have not moral courage to contradict a prejudice or to face ridicule. In daring to admit, nay, in daring to invite a Negro to an audience at the White House, Mr. Lincoln did that which he knew would be offensive to the crowd and excite their ribaldry. It was saying to the country, I am the president of the black people as well as the white, and I mean to respect their rights and feelings as men and as citizens. When Douglas was admitted to the president's office, he found him easy to talk with. He set me at perfect liberty to state where I differed from him as freely as where I agreed with him. From the first 5 minutes, I seemed to myself to have been acquainted with him during all my life. He was one of the very few white Americans who could converse with a Negro without anything like condescension and without in any way reminding him of the unpopularity of his color. Douglas recalled one episode in particular that demonstrated Lincoln's kindly, what he called kindly disposition toward colored people. While Douglas was talking with the president, a White House aide on two occasions announced that the governor of Connecticut was sitting in an adjacent room, eager for an interview. Tell the governor to wait, said the president. I want to have a long talk with my friend Douglas. Their conversation continued for another hour. Douglas later speculated that this was probably the first time in the history of the country when the governor of a state was required to wait for an interview because the president of the United States was engaged in conversation with a Negro. Douglas did not rely on his own experience to explain why Lincoln should be considered emphatically the black man's president. He told the Cooper Union audience about, quote, one of the most touching scenes connected with the funeral of our lamented president, which occurred at the gate of the presidential mansion. A colored woman standing at the gate weeping was asked the cause of her tears. Oh, sir, she said, we have lost our Moses. But, said the gentleman, the Lord will send you another, surely. That may be, said the weeping woman, but we had him. This woman, according to Douglas, represented millions of blacks who, from first to last, through all, whether through good or evil report, fully believed in Abraham Lincoln. Despite his initial tardiness in attacking slavery, Douglas said, they firmly trusted in him, with a faith that constituted no blind trust, unsupported by reason. Blacks had early caught a glimpse of the man, and from the evidence of their senses, they believed in him. They viewed him not in the light of separate individual acts, but in the light of his mission, in his manifest relation to events, and in the philosophy of his statesmanship. Viewing him thus, they trusted him as men are seldom trusted. They did not care what forms of expression the president adopted, whether it were justice, expedience, or military necessity, so long as they could see slavery abolished and liberty established in the country. Well, it's a remarkable speech, and it deserves to be a lot better known. Well, the larger point I wish to make is that this imagery of Lincoln as the father of the country was so widespread, and it illustrates a point which I think is essential to understand if we were to understand how it was that Lincoln was a successful political leader. And that was Lincoln radiated a quality of wise, paternal wisdom, nurturance, experience, and the like. And it's hard to explain just why Lincoln had that quality. Now, I'm inclined to offer psychological explanations for a lot of historical phenomena. I am a psychohistorian. That's one word. There are psychohistorians as two words, but I flatter myself that I do not belong to that category, although not everybody I know would agree with that. In any event, and when I published my first book, which was called The Inner World of Abraham Lincoln, which is a series of psychological essays about his relations with his parents and with his children and his wife and his depressions and his midlife crisis and all that sort of thing. I wanted to call it Shrinkin' Lincoln. But my stuffy old publisher, the University of Illinois Press, wouldn't allow me to do that. Anyway, so it's called. And in that book, I dealt with this question of how Lincoln's image, how he managed to radiate a quality of wise paternal fatherhood that inspired a kind of trust and respect that was essential for Lincoln's success as president. And it's hard to explain it in terms of his early upbringing, his relations with his parents, or the like. They're more traditional means of offering psychological explanations. And so I found what I thought was a plausible explanation in the psychology of the great Swiss psychologist Carl Jung. Jung, as many of you may know, argues that we're all born under an archetype that has nothing to do with our parents or the like, and that profoundly affects our lives. It's a kind of given. And one of the archetypes is of the wise old man. And Lincoln seems to have been endowed with that. Because time and again, people referred to him as old, well before he looked old. But he radiated a quality of oldness. And in the positive sense of oldness, which we all here have, which is wisdom, trustworthiness, nurturance, supportive, and the like. And that gets underscored so dramatically in these responses during the mourning period for Lincoln that it helps me to establish the argument that that was one of the ingredients of his successful presidency. That one of the most important ingredients for leadership in any position is that the people that you are asked to help lead trust you, they respect you, they trust your judgment, they trust your integrity. And Lincoln managed not only through his actions, but by just radiating from his person those qualities. And so as we reflect upon Lincoln's death and upon his legacy and leadership, I think that's one of the most important elements to understand as the basis of his highly successful leadership. And I thank you for your attention.
Our closing words, again, are those of Walt Whitman from his well-known poem regarding Lincoln's death, "When Lilacs Last in Dooryard Bloomed." These are the final three lines. "For the sweetest, wisest soul of my days and lands, and this for his dear sake, lilac and star and bird twined with the chant of my soul, there in the fragrant pines and the cedars, dusk and dim."